Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Welcome back to Muslim Spaces Friday Khutbah. Inshallah, we're going to go ahead and get started here. Bismillah. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyi'ati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu wa man yudlilhu fala hadiya lahu. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. All praises due to Allah, from whom we seek help and forgiveness. We seek refuge with Allah from the evil of our own souls and from our bad deeds. Whomsoever Allah guides will never be led astray, and whomsoever Allah leads astray, no one can guide. I bear witness that there is no God but God, no God but Allah, the one having no partner. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Allah's servant and messenger. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu taqullaha haqqa tuqatih wa la tamutunna illa wa antum muslimun. Ya ayyuhan nas uttaqu rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahidatan wa khalaqa minha zawjaha wa batha minhuma rijalan kathiran wa nisa'a. Wattaqullaha alladhi tasaluna bihi wal arham. Inna allaha kana alaykum raqiba. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد. O ye who believe, be mindful of Allah in the way that Allah deserves, and do not die except in a state of full submission to Allah. O humanity, be mindful of your Creator, who created you from a single soul, and from it created its mate, and through both Allah spread countless men and women. And be mindful of Allah, in whose name you appeal to one another, and honor your ties of kinship. Surely Allah is watchful over you. O ye who believe, be mindful of Allah and say what is right. Allah will bless your deeds for you and forgive your sins. And whoever obeys Allah and the Messenger of Allah has truly attained a great triumph. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wahlul uqdatal min lisani yafqahu qawli. Assalamu alaikum, everyone. Once again, welcome back to the Friday Khutbah for Muslim Space. And many of us are fairly familiar with the role of a shepherd. It's something that's oftentimes popularized and romanticized in our thoughts. When we're growing up as kids, we oftentimes see, you know, a drawing of a shepherd that's usually a man. It doesn't have to be, but, you know, it's usually, you know, a man or someone just dressed in these elegant robes, you know, simple, elegant robes that are there, maybe holding a sheep or a goat, and the goat is usually smiling, and it seems like a very happy thing that's going on. And so this image of a shepherd oftentimes comes with so many different caricatures that are put in a positive note, but very romanticized version of what shepherding is like, that it seems like, oh, anybody can just do it, and it'll be such a stress reliever if I just leave my job and I go to the hillside and I start just shepherding sheep. I'll be wearing the same simple robes and living a happy life, and I'll be smiling and the sheep will be smiling. Everybody will be happy. And so we sometimes have this conception of a shepherd in our minds, but it's oftentimes not a complete image. If we think about and if we investigate really what is the role of a shepherd and what is it like to not only just deal with sheep, but to deal with other animals and to have to, you know, serve in that capacity, we'll find that it's not, you know, the grass isn't really that much greener on the other side. So what I wanted to lift up today, inshallah, for this khutbah was with regards to the example of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The Quran says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ, that in the Messenger of Allah, you have uswatun hasana, a perfect example, a good model, an excellent pattern of how you conduct yourself, how you are in the religion, how you are to your neighbors, how you are holistically. And so when we look at the Prophet, we oftentimes will derive different patterns of how to be our best selves. And oftentimes there can be a bit of a disconnect because, of course, Rasulullah is Rasulullah. And there's only to one extent that we can really relate. But Rasulullah came as a model to show us not just how we can be in our religious lives, but how we can be holistically. And so what we see here in a sense with when we talk about shepherding, when we talk about these other things, is that when we look at the Prophet ﷺ, there's so many things that we can relate to, but because of our disconnect from that period, because of the time difference, because of the change in society, a lot of times it can feel like this isn't a relatable person. This isn't a relatable time. This isn't a relatable context to what I'm doing now. And so things have changed drastically across the world from 6th and 7th century Arabia, let alone in Arabia itself. And so how do we connect to this image? How do we connect to the Prophet ﷺ better? And so what I propose, and this goes off of a book that I've read before, but we're going into a deep dive in it with Muslim Space through blogs and social media posts and whatnot, called Images of Pastoral Care. And what we see oftentimes is when we look at art, when we look at pictures, when we look at different things, they speak so much more than a simple sentence could, or just a few words can. There's that famous adage that a image is worth 1,000 words or even more. And that can't hold any truer, especially when we apply these images to the Uswatun Hasana, the perfect example that was set for us. And so when we look into the life of the Prophet ﷺ, when we look at it from this metaphor, this imagery, we see not just a greater appreciation for who the Prophet ﷺ was, but we also start to see the whole picture. We start to see as well for ourselves how much more we can be. If the Prophet ﷺ goes beyond the binds of the book for us of just the last messenger of God or the one whom the Quran was revealed to or anything that you can just summarize, but in terms of this rich imagery that we're very familiar with, we start to appreciate that prophethood more. We start to appreciate that example more, but then we also start to appreciate ourselves and our responsibilities more, because no longer are we, you know, the Prophet ﷺ didn't just come and say, here is exactly what I'm going to do, and then I'm leaving, and so you just do just like that, just go ahead and do that, and you know, I'm gone completely, and so there's that disconnect. Rather, it was a living example. It's an example of us that once the Prophet ﷺ left, it wasn't that now we have no example to follow, so I guess we just are left to our own devices. Rather, we were to follow in that sunnah, in that spiritual example that transcends any bound of time. And so when we look at the imagery of a shepherd or any kind of other imagery, and we apply it to the Prophet ﷺ, we start to see not only that work that he did and how much we appreciate that, but also how rich the example was for us. And then when we turn it to ourselves, how much we can live our lives more fully. So the objective of this khutbah, as well as the following khutbahs that will deep dive into some of these images, is to gain a greater appreciation for the lives that we live. Because we might think that, hey, I'm just an IT worker. I just work at an 8-to-5 job during the week. I just really have an ordinary life. We start to build deeper connections to all that is around us because we see the Prophet ﷺ set an example for this. And so when we turn it back to us, we see how much richer of an example it is, especially in our own context. And so there's a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that actually kicks us off on this concept that says that each of you is a shepherd and each of you has a responsibility for a flock. The Prophet ﷺ later went on and detailed that, you know, a man would be in charge of the inhabitants, or that he's not in charge necessarily, he's the shepherd for the inhabitants of his household. And similarly, a woman as well is a shepherd for her household. And so you have this distribution of responsibilities, and the Prophet ﷺ reminds them that each of you is a shepherd and each of you is responsible for his flock. And when we think about that, oftentimes we have this concept, especially in our cultural understandings, that the man is in charge of the house, or the woman is in charge of this, or the man is in charge of that. And we start to divvy up some things. But it's a really powerful metaphor when we see the Prophet ﷺ lift up this concept of shepherding and apply it to us as people, that you as a man, you are a shepherd for XYZ things. You as a woman, you're a shepherd for XYZ things as well. And you as Muslims holistically are shepherds, and each of you has a flock which is responsible for. That doesn't mean that, you know, we're looking outside trying to see where did our flock of sheep go, or where did our animals go that we are in charge of shepherding over. But in each of our lives, we have something that we are shepherding. So just think to yourself, what is your flock? What is that which you are caretaking, which you're watching over for? Now, before we jump into that, though, it's important to understand what shepherding is. Like I said, we have an often romanticized term of shepherding that says there's somebody with a shepherd's like cane and is walking around peacefully. They probably have a big beard, they have a big smile, and these animals are running around happily. And the story kind of goes from there. So it's a very romantic setting, very nice setting that's there. But in reality, if you talk to a shepherd, if you look at what shepherding is, you'll find that shepherding is actually not a very romanticized thing. It's not a very well compensated job. Sheep are actually very stinky and very hard to control animals. They have minds of their own, so they're going left and right, whatnot. They get dirty really fast. There's a lot, and you know, when you're shepherding them, you're not just trying to just stand there, have them pose for a picture, and you also pose for a picture, and everybody looks good and it's smiles and sunshine, but you have a very specific objective. You're trying to get them fed, you're trying to keep them in a certain area, you're trying to help them graze, but then also as a shepherd, you are protecting them. You are, there might be a threat around, whether it's a wolf or some other predator, and the shepherd's job as well there is to help protect the sheep that the shepherd is shepherding. And what's important is that not the shepherd doesn't just walk in and say, hey, sheep, this is what you're going to do. You're going to listen to me. You're going to do this. You're going to do that. And just dictate everything, because the sheep don't understand. The sheep are going, not processing it in that way. And the sheep will do what they want. The shepherd is just there to help steer them, help get them to the proper place. And if one of these sheep are wounded, or if something happens, the shepherd is the one that tends to them. The shepherd makes sure that not one sheep goes away or goes astray. The shepherd is very much aware in an ideal sense. Again, like I said, not this isn't reflective of the profession of shepherding holistically and for every single shepherd, but ideally, in an ideal sense, when a shepherd is put in charge of a flock or takes charge of a flock, they are not just responsible to command this flock to do this and do that. They're responsible for the care of that flock. They're responsible for the pastoral care of that flock, the needs of the least, the needs of the most, and how to get everybody home safe, how to get all the flock back home safe after they have gone out. And so it's a very relevant image for us when we think about in our life, what is our flock? Do we have a literal flock? Is our flock our home? What is the flock in our life that needs shepherding? And so when we talk about the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, this khutbah was titled as the shepherding prophet. First off, the Prophet ﷺ was a shepherd in all aspects of it. The Prophet ﷺ was a literal shepherd. He had mentioned in a hadith that Allah did not send any prophet but one that shepherded sheep. So shepherding was seen as a prophetic profession in a sense. And so it was something that all the prophets had done. And his companions asked him, did you do the same? And the Prophet ﷺ said, yes, I used to shepherd the sheep of the people of Mecca. For just a few, for a few dirhams, for a few earnings. And so the Prophet ﷺ himself was a literal shepherd when he was a young adult. We know he became a merchant, and he became involved in that line of work. But in his youth, he was a shepherd. He dealt with sheep, he dealt with different kinds of animals there. But we don't want to just discount that in a sense that, oh, the Prophet ﷺ was a shepherd, so automatically he meets the requirement for a prophethood. No, you think about what it takes to shepherd those which cannot speak, those which are not humans. You think about the patience that's developed when you work with animals. You think about the sometimes the stress that you get when one animal is lost, especially if you've been charged to take care of these animals, and all of a sudden one runs away. It's as if you lost the whole flock. So you want to make sure that that you take care of this. And so there's a lot of responsibility that's built in for shepherds, especially when they're at a young age. But we see also later on that how the Prophet ﷺ was as a shepherd in his youth, it informed how he was the shepherd of people in his later life, as a spiritual leader, as the leader of his community in Mecca when they were a persecuted minority, in Medina when they were finally a community that could stand on its own legs. He was a different kind of shepherd throughout each part of his life. But He shepherded to different people. He shepherded to people who were on the margins. He shepherded to people who were doing very well off. He shepherded to Muslims. He shepherded to non-Muslims. He even shepherded to people, or he even shepherded to things that were not human. He shepherded to things in the environment, things that were animals. So he had this holistic aspect of shepherding. And when we look at that, it shouldn't make us just stop and say, well, that was the Prophet ﷺ, so only he could do that. Only that's something that the Prophet ﷺ could do. We're only going to do something else. And this kind of undermines that concept of uswatun hasana for us, in a sense, when the Quran tells us that in the Prophet ﷺ, you have an example, an excellent model, a pattern of behavior to follow. We see that in the Prophet ﷺ's example, when the Prophet ﷺ would shepherd to all different kinds of people, all different kinds of things in his life, whether literally or metaphorically, there's a lesson for us to take when we go from this Jummah, when we go into our own lives, and we think about what are we responsible, what are we taking care of, and what are we going for? So I want to lift up a few things of the Prophet ﷺ as in holding true to this khutbah title of the shepherding prophet. But I also want us to think about what it is like for each of us to conduct ourselves in a manner of a shepherd, because the Prophet ﷺ said that each of you is a shepherd. So we are all shepherds. We just have to kind of find our flock. Sometimes it might be hard for us to find what that flock is. Not all of us have literal flocks, but we think about, what is that flock? Is it our job? Is it our family? Is it all these different things? And so thinking about that, but then also thinking about what are the things that are our flock, but we don't think about them immediately, that we're just passing them by. Sometimes it might be the person who's on the street asking for some money, that person that we see all the time. We're like, oh yeah, that's the homeless guy that just stands at the corner and asks for that. Or we take a walk through a park and we see all these different trees and whatnot, and we see somebody litter there, and we're just like, oh, this is a park, you know, I walk through here all the time. I guess somebody just, you know, that person has no manners or whatnot. That's a rude person. And we think about all these things, and we start to connect even more. And what we get from the Prophet ﷺ was this aspect of connection. So what I want to lift up today, just in a sense of the Prophet ﷺ's role itself as a shepherd, literal, metaphorical, and what lessons we can take for it. So as I mentioned, the role of a shepherd is really important to explicate first, to just give you an idea, because we often have this romanticized version of a shepherd. And if you Google shepherd, you might get a very, like, you know, these biblical pictures and storybook pictures of somebody very nice and smiley and happy sheep and all that. But what we know is that shepherds in all their capacity, and I'm talking literally here, but also you think of the metaphor as well, but shepherds here literally lead, guide, nurture, heal, and seek out the lost sheep. Seek out the lost of their flock. If just making sure everybody, everything in that flock is accounted for, bringing the scattered parts of the flock back together, making sure everything stays as a whole, but also protecting it from harm. The Prophet ﷺ, in his role as a shepherd, was one who did these very things with the community. But then also, as I mentioned, shepherding is not a very romanticized profession. It's something that's very dirty. It's something that is very difficult to try and get all the flock together to take care of sheep, to do all this stuff. It is a very difficult thing. It's something that leaves you a lot dirtier than you had entered. So there's a lot of this stuff kind of going on. And the Prophet ﷺ was someone that shepherded his community much in the way that he shepherded the animals when he was a youth. It wasn't to say that the Prophet ﷺ took his stick and just started hitting these people, in a sense that, oh, that's what shepherds do. No, the Prophet ﷺ took shepherding as it was and said that this is what all the prophets did before they came, was that they were shepherds. And why? Because when you see a shepherd dives into this, to the flock and makes sure that each of these aspects of the flock is taken care of, but then also that everybody gets home safe, but not in a way that says, like, as a harsh dictator. There's no harshness and room for this in shepherding. There may be a slight correction, in a sense, if you see a sheep that is going off, but it's done with gentleness. The Prophet ﷺ taught us that when there was a man that was, you know, had mistreated his camel, and the camel was very visibly, upset or distraught, the Prophet ﷺ had come to the camel and put his hand on the side of the camel's neck and said to the person who owned it, he said, be very aware and be very mindful of these which cannot speak. You know, he was admonishing the man that be aware that even these things that don't speak, these animals that don't speak, they have rights too. And if you don't uphold them, that's a matter between you and Allah. And so when you think about how the Prophet ﷺ would care for these animals, think about how that translated to how he would care for his community. When he cared for his community, as I mentioned, the Prophet was a literal and a metaphorical shepherd. In his youth, he had become a shepherd in Mecca, and this literal shepherding was something that helped him prepare. But as a shepherd of the community, the Prophet watched over everyone, not only everybody, but every aspect of the community in a way that's not to say from a lens of control. Because the shepherd in the model of shepherding is not one that says, this is my flock and I'm controlling this flock. It's not from a lens of control. It's from a lens of care. And so the Prophet, when he would oversee his community, was not to say like, I have full control and everybody's obeying me and everything like that. The Prophet looked at it like a shepherd looks at a flock and says, is everybody all right? Are the sheep getting their food? Is everybody fed? Is someone hurt? Is all these things happening? And not looking at it from that lens of, okay, you know, I'm going to make money off of these people. I'm going to, you know, quantify them. There's just this many, this many, this many. And so there's all these different things that are there that are not shepherding, that oftentimes get confused with someone overseeing a community, especially in the role of the Prophet. And he did this in a way that would risk his own well-being and his own life. And so we see in Medina and in Mecca, the Prophet, he dealt with his community in a way that he would deal with himself. So when they migrated and under the threat of persecution from Mecca, he was the last to migrate. He was the last to go out with them. When they went to battle in Medina, when they stood up for the defense of Islam, he was there along with them in the front lines. He wasn't just someone who was a shepherd that was standing from afar and yelling at them and say, hey, go do this, go do that, go do that, go do that. He was someone that was intimately involved in the affairs. And he's teaching us that what's that aspect life of an intimate shepherd, of not just a shepherd that wields a stick and just, you know, just hits the animals and says, go this way, go that way. He was a shepherd that would walk alongside those of which he was shepherding, and he would care for each of them. We see so many examples of the Prophet in this care that is administered in gentleness and tenderness, in sense of extending that care to aspects of his community that were human and people and the things in its community that were non-human. I lifted up the aspect of the camel. There's so many different traditions of the Prophet going with his companions. They're headed towards Mecca. And I believe this was on the road to the conquest of Mecca, but there was a dog that was laying on the road, and she was feeding her pups. And so the Prophet ﷺ had ordered the army to take a detour around. He set up a companion to stay watch over this dog as she nurses her pups, and direct the entire army around this litter, this dog and her litter. And so you see the care that the Prophet ﷺ had. You've seen how leaders in our world are today, and we can relate probably more to them than we can in this sense, but when we will just exploit certain things, we will just take certain things for granted that, oh, I'm on my, you know, I'm going through this. Oh, who cares if I knock down one thing or if I have to bulldoze something to get over something else? But the Prophet lived and shepherded in a way that was even one reflective when they were in the defense of Islam, when they were, when they had the armor on, when they had the armor off. He tried to instill a mindset of care that was not just for one another, but for everything that was there. And so just in closing here, what I want to lift up is that the Prophet ﷺ, first and foremost, brought this shepherding aspect to the care for the marginalized. As I mentioned, he cared for the human and the non-human in the community. And as a shepherd, he was there that were wounded. He spent his time with those who were weak, who were widowed, who were orphans, who were just, you know, on the outcast, the foreigners. So the Prophet, when shepherding this community, treated it in a way that he would be as a literal shepherd. He spent the time specifically with those that were maybe the most vulnerable, the shepherd hanging around the sheep that would not be able to maybe help themselves as much. So being there, not in a way to admonish them and say, hey, catch up with the rest of the group, go be with the rest of the group. Why are you just being, you know, lazy sheep that are weak, like, you know, complaining? He would rather pick them up. He would be with them and he would care for them and make sure that the rest of the sheep are not going anywhere as long as this sheep has not gone somewhere. And so this care for the marginalized was there. We see the Prophet ﷺ having in his own mosque a shelter for homeless people, having a shelter for those who are refugees, those who are foreigners, the Ahl al-Suffa, the people who just came, they're the people of the bench. They literally lived outside the Prophet's home in the mosque, but having a dedicated portion there to which he would set up and he would spend time with these people. There was an incident where a woman in the Hadith had mental illness. She had a reported mental illness or some kind of illness that was reported in her mind. And she came and told the Prophet, I wish to sit in your company. And the Prophet said, pick any single spot that you want. I'll sit there with you. And she goes, she leads him to this one spot in the town, and they sit down, and she tells him whatever she had to tell him. And he follows her along in that sense. You know, you think about how we are to shepherd to the people in our lives. How are we to be shepherds in our lives? It's not going to be through harshness and through being mean and through being controlling. It's through being caring. The Prophet ﷺ knew this woman had a mental illness. She may not have been completely there, but he still gave her the agency. He said, pick whichever place you want to go, I'll be there. And he was present with that person. Just like in our context, if someone comes and asks something of us, oftentimes we will think, well, let me check my calendar. Let me see if that'll add up and whatnot. Rarely do we do it with the other sense. Like, what works for you? You know, where absolutely, you have my full attention. You came all this way here. Let's talk. Where would you like to go? The presence that the Prophet ﷺ had for the marginalized, for people in his community, is a direct aspect of the shepherding that is not just one limited to the literal context, but also to our context here. And so apart from that, we also see that the Prophet ﷺ, as a shepherd, cared as a prophet with that tenderness, with that gentleness. And what I want to close on here today, inshallah, is that we're going to be talking about the Prophet ﷺ in these different images. And as I mentioned, images can convey a much richer description of a role, a much richer description than a simple sentence could ever. And so in this image, we have the role of a shepherd. And when we think about the Prophet ﷺ, it's not to completely elevate the Prophet ﷺ to just one end and to completely debase his community to the other end, to say one was a shepherd, the other were sheep, but rather to see that we pull back this metaphor and we start to inform it for what it really is, that we're not just saying that we're all just sheep and we just all are just going like this, but recognizing the holistic aspect of this, that shepherds are not just those individuals that just, you know, have full control over a flock and they just order them to do around. The shepherds are some individuals that are very involved with their flock. And the flock itself is not something that is mindless and running around. The flock itself has very different needs and very different things that the shepherd has to be present to. So we're going to lift up, inshallah, in this khutbah and in the next few khutbahs, this element of pastoral and spiritual care. This is something that's in my own background as chaplain. This is my wheelhouse per se, and it's oftentimes seen in a Christian context when you think of a pastor or pastoral care. But that word pastoral or that word pastor comes from the Latin word of essentially shepherding. And so when we look at the context of the Prophet's example, the Prophet was an example for all of humanity, and as an extension was an example for each of us, that we emulate certain aspects of this example or as much of it as we can in our own lives. And one of those examples was that of a shepherd. And so when we look at what does it mean to be a shepherd, it means that you're going to have your hands in the mud. You're going to be doing difficult things, but you will also have those moments of joy. You're going to have a holistic setting. And so what this image helps us do is to see the role of the Prophet, not just as one romanticized that he was the prophet of God, he got the message and he lived a life like that and everything was green and sunshine and happy and whatnot, but he had very difficult moments in his life. He had moments where his flock had hurt him. He had moments where there were sheep in his flock that ran away. He had moments where he, as a shepherd, felt that he couldn't do this because he wasn't competent enough. There's all these images that are there that are packed into that image of a shepherd. So when we look at a non-romanticized version of a shepherd and see not just the successes, but the struggles that go into it, the ins and out of the job, what is difficult, what is easy, what kind of breaks the back, what helps give relief, all these different things, we see the role of the Prophet as holistic as that. And so, inshallah, in the next khutbah, we will talk again of another image, and that will be of the wounded healer. But these images are going to be ones that help show us how rich the Prophet's example was, and then hopefully allow us to see that how rich that example still is, because we are still trying to live into that example. And so we're not just regular Muslim Joe Schmoes. We are people that are in the line of the Prophet's sunnah. And one of those lines is, as the Prophet said, you are all shepherds and you are all responsible for your flock. So inshallah, we ask that Allah allow us to identify our flock. Allow us to not just identify our flock, but to be with our flock, to be good shepherds, to be good stewards, as the Prophet was, not a harsh, not a controlling, not a alienating type of shepherd that did things for his own interest, but a shepherd that sought the care of all that was around and allowed that shepherding for us to go beyond our flock to everything that is around us. And inshallah, we will look more into not just the shepherding image, but also one that is of other images of pastoral care and relate them to the Prophet ﷺ. The last thing I'll just say is that is with respect to this care. The caring that a shepherd provides, I've said this before, but I want to say it again. The caring that the Prophet ﷺ provided, the caring that a shepherd provides, is one that isn't romanticized. It's oftentimes romanticized because we see it in children's books and it's nice and, you know, making us feel really nice, but it's very costly. It's unsettling and it's even distasteful at times, but it has a very strong reward that comes with it as well. So shepherds must have characteristics of tenderness. They must be skilled in leadership, or at least, you know, have developing those skills. They must be concerned with not just themselves, but others, everything that's around, and they must be aware. So these are all aspirational things for us. We might be like, well, I'm not tender. I'm a very harsh person, or, hey, I'm not a good leader. I'm not very aware. Or, I'm not very concerned or whatnot. These are things we can all develop because all the people around the Prophet as well didn't have a perfect resume or perfect CV as well to go with it. These were people that learned from the Prophet ﷺ, and just like them, we are learning as well. So inshallah, may Allah grant us the strength and fortitude to be the best of shepherds in our flocks and for one another in all matters. Ibadallah, rahimakumullah, inna Allah ya'muru bil adli wal ihsan wa ita'ati al qurba wa yanha 'anil fahsha'i wal munkari wal baghi ya'idhukum la'allakum tadhakkarun. Udhkurullaha yadhkurkum wad'uhu yastajib lakum wa ladhikrullahi akbar. O servants of Allah, may Allah be merciful to you. Verily, Allah commands you to act with justice, to confer benefits upon each other, and to do good to others as one does to one's kindred, and forbids evils which pertain to one's own self and evils which affect others, and prohibits unlawful rebellion against lawful authority. He warns you against being unmindful. You remember Allah, Allah too will remember you. You call unto Allah and Allah will make a response to your call. And verily, divine remembrance is the highest virtue. Rabbana taqabbal minna innaka antas samiul alim. Our Lord, accept this service from us, for thou art all-hearing, all-knowing. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidu majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidu majid. Jazakallah khair, everyone. I hope that you find this Jummah and for all the days to come be blessed. Inshallah, you have a good weekend. And assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you for coming.